Cause we live, bitches. What is up, everybody? So glad to see you. So happy that you're here. And I'm happy to be here, to be perfectly honest, for another episode of the Horror Movie Club, the club where what do? We watch horror movies, of course. Always try to make sure that the movie that we're watching is something that is not behind a paywall. That way, you can just click on the link. It's down below in the description, and you can watch a full, unedited version of tonight's film. Uncensored. Usually it's a link to something like Tubi or Plex or any number of these free streaming sites. It's amazing how many there are and the movies that they've got up there, man. Tonight's movie is The Bride by Frank Rodham from 1985, which is, despite its flaws, a personal favorite of mine. It came out in 1985, obviously. It is a kind of sequel slash remake of The Bride of Frankenstein, of course. And what can I say? It absolutely got slammed by the critics when it came out. And it also got absolutely pilloried by audiences. I don't know anybody that saw this movie that that liked it. And so I avoided it when it was in its theatrical release. But then I read a review in Cinema Fantastique magazine, which was basically like an upscale version of like Starlog or Fangoria, right? And the review was very, very good. And it was comparing the movie to Jean Cocteau, specifically La Belle et la Bête, his version of Beauty and the Beast, which if you've never seen it, is fucking phenomenal. And is a must-see, really, if you're a horror fan. Incredible imagery in that film. And this movie does borrow from Cocteau quite a bit. It borrows from James Whale, borrows from Mary Shelley. It does a lot of interesting things. And if you were like me and you were a lover of all things Frankenstein, yeah, you absolutely owe it to yourself to, at the very least, give it a look. But anyway, enough of my yapping. Let me bring in my co-hosts. First, of course, my boy, your boy, Matt. What's going on?
Oh, I gotta say, Rick Baker, he actually did a painting on Instagram where I think it was a charcoal or ink of the Beauty and the Beast that you spoke of. Pretty awesome, like a couple days ago. Such a good illustrator. I gotta say, man, I really dug this movie. It was fun seeing Clancy Brown be Frankenstein's monster. Sting did a great job in here. I love seeing the character become somewhat retarded, turn into an actual human throughout the progress of the movie. He's getting smarter and smarter, and I was hoping for him to do that. I love the addition of the dwarf and the whole carnival aspect of the
story.
He got some revenge too, so that was cool too. But yeah, I really dug the movie, and I love the pint, the pail scene. That's one of my favorites.
Glad that you got a kick out of it, man. I figured that you would. And then of course we gotta bring on Preston Acevedo. What's going on, brother, man?
I like the dwarf too. I thought the dwarf was amazing.
Oh yeah, my god. Fucking
Without the dwarf, the movie wouldn't have been more worth watching.
Nah, I think he really made the movie in some ways. He brought that emotional core, you know?
Yeah, he's the heart of it. It's David Rappaport was the actor's name.
And the pub scene was fucking amazing.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
great.
Yeah, it was.
The dwarf was like, yeah, we could do anything we want. And Frankenstein passes out, and he's like, uh-oh.
Yep. Yeah, because it's great because it's just like he's basically kind of like a saint, but he's also like a fucking an imp. Right, he's also like mischievous, but not like in a malicious way. Like when they steal from the church coffers, and then of course when he is using the monster as muscle, basically, but he's not using him to rough people up. He's just using the monster just to be like, hey, you can't fuck with me.
Well, I kind of felt like he was using the monster to get back at the world, you know.
Not like Bela Lugosi and not like Igor in Son of Frankenstein or something like that. He wasn't using them to like murder motherfuckers.
No, it wasn't that bad. It was just he just wanted to get
Master Blaster
back. Kind of like Master Blaster. It felt like a Master Blaster type of situation.
It's
that would have been cool though if they would have did something like that. Like he had like a little harness on his head where the dwarf sat there and just
You
rip that. Okay, go over there.
He holds his two beers for him.
Arms off.
That would have been awesome, dude.
And then of course we got Pops. What's going on, Pops?
Oh, just checking out stuff on the net. You know, dude, I've had a lousy day. I've tried to watch this movie all day long. Internet's been in, it's been out, it's been in, it's been out. I get to watch about 3 minutes, net's gone. Finally, I got frustrated. About halfway through it, the dwarf is funny. You're right. I like the dwarf. He's Tyrion for me in this, you know, like the little dwarf from Game of Thrones. That's how I'm seeing this little dude. He's like kind of directing shit. I like it. So, you know, I might get to watch it later. Who knows? Cheers, everybody.
Cheers, Pops. Cheers. David Rappaport, of course, wonderful in this film. Young Clancy Brown as the monster, wonderful in this film.
Awesome.
Really, a very underrated performance, also, I think, by Jennifer Beals. The critics especially went after her. Hard, and I do mean hard, because this was like the first major movie she made post Flashdance.
Ah, I knew she looked familiar,
right?
Yeah,
and so I think that the critics were kind of sharpening their knives. I think people kind of wanted to see her fail for some perverse reason, and then you have the casting of Sting.
Right.
The musician, not the wrestler, who, by the way, actually owns the original rights to the name and charges this Sting $1 a year to use the name.
He must be a wrestling
fan. Which is a pimp move, right? He hadn't done a lot of acting. He, of course, was in The Police. And this is before he started his very lucrative career making like basically elevator music.
He was also in Dune, though, wasn't he?
Right?
Yeah,
he was great in Dune.
He got killed, but he was awesome.
Well, he's one of those guys where if you cast him right,
yeah, he'll nail it.
He'll nail it.
It's like David Bowie.
That was a good part for him. Pedro Atha Harkonnen was a great part for Sting.
Yes, Fade Rather was a good part for Sting. And you know what? I think he makes a very good Frankenstein.
Yeah, I thought he did a good job. Frankenstein. His dramatic facial mannerisms like would hit perfectly, like the little eyebrow raise and like when he's about to deliver a big line. I don't know. I was like, oh, okay. And he looks like very cartoonish. He's got a very animated brow, you know. I thought he was a good choice, a good pick.
But like I said, the critics and audience we're all fucking like, stupid. Just like, it's stupid.
Hillary. As a caster, how do you come to Sting as Frankenstein without thinking of it as a comedy? Right?
Well, I'll tell you how this happened. I'll tell you how he got cast. The director of this was Frank Rodham, who had before this done a movie for The Who called Quadrophenia, which was a movie where The Who did the soundtrack, but the story was about the Mods versus the Rockers, which were these two rival factions of dandies, basically, in England in the 60s and very early 70s. And Sting was in that, I think, as one of the gang members, and also was working as like a bellboy or something like that. So Sting was in that. And there's other people in this that were also in Quadrophenia. Now, the guy that's hanging over his shoulder there playing Dr. Pretorius, a very memorable character from The Bride of Frankenstein, brilliantly fucking cast, because Dr. Pretorius is a very obviously gay character in the original Bride of Frankenstein. And Quentin Crisp was famous for a book he wrote called The Naked Civil Servant, which was about being a gay dude in like the 1950s and 60s, early 60s, right? And also a tranny, right? One director, I can't remember her name, referred to him as the true Queen of England. And Sting actually wrote a song about him called, how does it go again? I'm an alien. I'm a legal alien. I'm an Englishman in New York. He wrote that about Quentin Crisp. And when I was living in the city, you saw him quite a bit, because his entire life was about going out and having lunch with like gay college students who wanted to interview him. Right? So he ate free lunches all the time. You actually saw him quite a bit, especially in the summer. And I mean, you know, for Dr. Pretorius, you know, not that his part in this is big, but it's a perfect casting. There's Timothy Spall. I don't know if you guys are familiar with him. Very young looking here, very, very thin.
Crazy.
Do you know the actor?
Yeah, he's in a bunch of stuff, man. Tons of stuff. Dudes, I actually got to bounce right now. Sorry.
Trainer.
Yeah, I know. It's Clancy Brown.
Yeah. Well, first of all, fuck you for betraying us for your family. He wants to go and fucking see his daughters play instead of hanging out with us and talking about like crappy old monster movies. What's going on? Where are you going?
Right now I'm going to do an interview with Robert Geronimo about his book Blood Realm, Dawn of the Wolf, for a bit. And it's going to be on my channel, Metal Movies and Brewskis. The show's open the gates if you guys want to check it out. Thanks for having me on. Thanks for putting me on this movie. I really enjoyed it. And thanks, guys.
Cool.
I'll see you next week for some Western drama.
Oh yeah! I will try to drop that.
And I'll do my best to hold up his end of the show while he's
gone. I do that so you don't see my eyeballs. I'll see you guys later.
All right. Peace out, guys. Peace out, even Matt. Much love to you and your family, man.
You too, man.
Okay.
Peace out, guys.
This was also like God. Around, I forget if Highlander came out before or after this, because I know it was around the same time. May have even been the same year, actually, now that I'm thinking of it. Clancy Brown hadn't been in a lot of stuff. He was in Bad Boys, which was like a juvenile prison movie. Now, what I love about the monster in this, well, first of all, his performance is fucking phenomenal, I think. He's for me, he's my favorite Frankenstein monster after Karloff. His performance in this is really wonderfully moving. And what you'll notice is as the film goes on, he looks less and less monstrous. Like his wounds, like the big open wound on his head, for instance.
Yeah, it closes up. Yeah.
Right? Where the brain went in, most likely. That closes up, and then it seems to heal over, and then it's just like, it's very subtle. It's very subtle. It's subtle to the point where you can miss it until suddenly you notice, damn, he actually looks kind of like handsome and dashing, right? By the end of the movie, when he's got the coat on and everything, right? And his hair is kind of grown out a little bit, and you're just like, this is the evolution of the Frankenstein monster. This movie is the son of Frankenstein that I wanted to see when I was a kid, right? Because in the first James Whale Frankenstein, the monster is like a baby. He's like an infant, right? And he's been abused, and that's why he's violent. Then you get to the second movie, and there's that very tenderly wrought scene where Opie Heggie, as the old blind man, teaches him how to speak, right? So then he can speak in the second film, not well, but enough to, let himself and his intentions be known. And what I was hoping for as a kid was that by the third film, that's when he would be Shelley's monster, right? That's when he'd start quoting Milton and, not that he quite gets there in this, but he absolutely does evolve. And I think that Brown's performance is just, especially for a guy who was really young at the time, is really extraordinary. What did you guys think? Pops, I know you've been trying to watch this. Preston, have you ever seen this movie?
Yeah, I seen it when I was a kid. The one thing I didn't remember was the intro, where they had the head in the glass. And,
God, it's such a great sequence.
They're trying to stop the sand, and there's this weight. And it almost seemed like Frankenstein was having an orgasm, in the intro.
Oh, that's right. Because what happens, we discover, is that during the vivification process on the bride, whenever the lightning strikes and strikes her, he's having this thing, right? A jolt's going through him. And that's the connection between them that gets established, because they do have a psychic connection. She is, after all, literally made for him.
Yeah.
Right? And let me run the trailer for this really quick.
The other thing I didn't remember was the half of the female body in the tube that was getting electrocuted at the same time.
Oh yeah, man! When it just falls out after the damn thing is shattered.
I must have watched that on cable because she's completely naked from the waist down, and I don't know. I don't remember seeing that when I was a kid.
Yeah, it's like the bottom of a woman's torso. You remembered the severed head, though.
Yeah.
That's hard to forget.
Once I seen it again, I remembered it. It was, yeah.
Yeah, the opening for this is spectacular. It is almost completely without dialogue. I wish that they hadn't included. There's like, at one point Pretorius says something, and then Frankenstein just tells him to shut up. I would have done this scene completely mute, but you'll notice if you watch this movie too, that when they do say something to each other, their heads are turned. So you don't see their mouths moving, so it seems like that dialogue was afterthought. Yeah, and there's Timothy Spall as Paulus, who's basically the Fritz character. The Fritz character is the one that most people think of as Igor, but Igor is actually the villain in Son of Frankenstein, played by Bela Lugosi. He's the guy who gets hit hung and his neck gets broken, and then it heals back in an improper way, so his head is always like at an angle. And they let him live because it's like, well, they can't hang him twice, right? And then he ends up using the monster to get back at the man at second school. The special effects here, I think, are really great. This is just, I don't know, I just thought this was a really great idea. And like the bungee cords, right? It makes more sense than a table. This way she could flop around and without hurting herself.
Raise the arm! She must come down!
Yeah, this part where I'm like, get her down! Stop the sand! Stop the sand. And the dude's just like, he's holding his hand over his hand. I'm like, that's not going to work. That's not going to work, dude.
Total non sequitur in The Werewolf's Guide to Life. That's a book I was telling you about. There's an audio version of it too, which is fantastic. This is the setup kind of that you want when you turn into a werewolf, because that way it's like you ain't getting loose, you ain't snapping any chains. Right, you ain't knocking down doors or crashing through walls.
I did have one comment about this particular scene.
Yeah,
it's the beginning of the movie. They're not killing the bride. I at no time did I think she was in danger of dying.
Yeah, I didn't think so either.
You see what I'm saying? Weird. So it was like they really kind of hyped the scene that really didn't make any sense. Because
that's because this movie is beginning with the climax of Bride of Frankenstein.
I'm just saying, it's like
I see what Brian's saying. They're paying homage.
I'm just saying, it's not like bad. You didn't get no. They made he acted like she's dead. Oh, she's dead. And it's like, no, she's not. Fucking movie.
No. Well, because she's not alive, right? And we don't get all the details in the original Bride of Frankenstein. She's part flesh and blood, but she's also partly synthetic.
Yeah.
Dr. Pretorius is the one who creates her brain. So they don't take the brain of a dead woman and put it, right? So she's not exactly like the monster, which accounts for her very, very odd behavior. And that crazy fucking hairdo, of course, which is so magnificent and iconic, but you could never do it in a movie like this because it would get laughed off the screen. Because it's silly, but it's awesome.
It's the Marge Simpson, man. It looks great.
And yeah, what happens here is she gets zapped and brought to life, but then he's freaking out because he's thinking like, oh no, well she's keeps getting now. Zapped. He was afraid that she was going to get barbecued. And of course you know that she's not going to die, but it's the beginning of the movie.
Will you stop the sand?
Will you stop the sand?
God, we're losing her.
These are not so alone, being alone. Yeah, and the monster.
Mine.
Is busting a nut. It looks like he's busting a nut. I'm not denying that. But yeah, it's because he's. This connection is forming between him and Veronica as she's
being born.
And there, basically, he's feeling her pain. Oh, yeah, there's
the head.
Yeah. And there's the bottom half of a woman just floating around. Now, one of the things I could have used more of in this film is more of these, like, I mean, this is a great gothic set piece, right? Usually, this is the scene that's always reserved for the climax of the Frankenstein films, yeah, right?
That's what I mean.
Right, but this begins. This is this begins with a climax, right? When we come into the story, the Frankenstein monster is just sitting there. It's like one of the first things you see in the film is really the first image is Frankenstein looking out the window, right? Because obviously you need the, he needs the weather, he needs the lightning and all that stuff. And then the next shot is the monster looking over at him. And you realize, you know, if you know the story, he's laid down the ultimatum. It's just like, make me a mate and I will disappear forever. You will never, ever, ever hear from me again. Of course, things don't go as planned. I love that the severed head is babbling too.
They're destroying her!
Like the original Bride of Frankenstein. Like that was that was actually Frankenstein's fiance that got made into the bride, right?
No,
I thought it was.
No, Elizabeth survives both of the first two Frankenstein films. See, that's what's odd about this. Is it like, is it following Mary Shelley? Is it following the Universal monster movies? The answer is it's not doing either of those things. It's just doing its own thing.
There's nothing wrong with that. I think
no, it's to be encouraged, I say. Yes, and then of course the moment of truth. Yeah, there it went. That's what you're talking. That's what you're talking about, Preston, right there. Check that out.
Yeah, it's completely fried. It flops down.
Yeah, he ain't making nothing out of that. Now, if you remember the novel, Frankenstein doesn't make the bride. He starts on her, and then he just fucking destroys the creation before he even brings her to life, because then he's thinking, oh, fuck, what if I make her, and then she and the monster go off, and they create a race of monsters, right? A curse upon mankind. And so he destroys the bride before he even brings her to life, and that's when the monster makes his declaration, I will be with you on your wedding night. And that's his vow, of course, to murder Elizabeth Frankenstein.
And that was covered in a Robert De Niro movie, I'm pretty sure, wasn't it? Like,
yeah. To be honest, in the De Niro movie, the one by what's his face, Kenneth Branagh, Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, it's called. In that, you know, Elizabeth gets turned into the bride.
I hated that movie.
I hated that movie, but I love that moment. I thought that was clever as hell. And then when she catches fire and she's running through the house and everything's catching fire, you know, I mean, a little fire at the end of your gothic horror movie is never a bad idea.
Especially when it's a terrible movie, because that whole movie was horrible.
It was shit. It was shit. I'm not fond of it. I really just didn't.
They were hoping Robert De Niro would carry that whole movie and make it great.
Meanwhile, he did not give a fuck. Yeah. He didn't care. He was very open about that too. That he showed up for a paycheck, and he is such a lazy motherfucker. Who's had so much, like, people like him, people like Brando. They've had so much smoke blown up their asses.
Bruce Willis. Even though Bruce Willis is having a hard time. Well, he never cared. He actually said he was always in it for the paycheck. He didn't give a shit.
Right.
About what, you know. But
rightfully so, he has no talent.
Well, the one thing I never... Did you see that movie Knox Goes Away? I posted about it. Like, that movie was really good. Yeah. And it's...
Knox Goes Away. No.
Michael Keaton. Soon. Michael Keaton plays Knox, right? And he's a hitman for the mob. And he starts having early signs of dementia, you know?
Okay.
So he goes to the doctor, and apparently it's some advanced version of dementia where he only has like a month or two, you know? And so he starts getting all his affairs in order. And what happens is he has an attack on a hit and he kills his partner. You know, he shoots him and he sets the whole scene up to look like, you know, like they killed each other, like the hit, the mark and his partner killed each other. Mm-hmm. The problem is that they were all shot with the same gun, his gun, you know? So he's running on borrowed time at the moment, you know? So he's trying to get everything in line before he gets caught. It's a crazy fucking movie. But like I told my wife, I was like,
you would recommend it?
Oh yeah, dude, it's great. But the deal is like, that's kind of what Bruce Willis was going through before he actually lost his mind. You know what I'm saying? Like now he can't talk. He just giggles.
Yeah. I mean, it's dementia. It's ugly, man. It is ugly. Terrible. I'm hoping that, that there will be a cure soon. It looks like there will be, right? They know what it is. They know what it is now, which is the first step.
Right now, they can treat freaking, what's the one? The one that you lose your memory there.
Not Alzheimer's?
They can treat Alzheimer.
Well, they were always able to treat it.
They can retard it. They can actually like make sure that you don't have it. That's what Answorth's going through. Chris Answorth.
Nice.
He got
diagnosed like early on, and so he's on treatment and shit like that. And that's what he's on. And he might not have to deal with the big issue.
You know,
later.
I hope so.
With Chris Hemsworth and Bruce Willis, actually, maybe Bruce Willis, but I know for a fact Chris Hemsworth, like because he was playing Thor, you know, he had to keep his body like super, super, super lean, you know,
right?
And like take like steroids. And I mean, they're going to say he never took steroids. Motherfucker was taking steroids.
They all do, dude, or human growth hormone, whatever the fuck it is.
But his contract stated like he was not able to eat certain foods because he had to have like almost zero body fat. The problem is that your brain needs cholesterol, you know,
it
needs cholesterol and fats. And you deny your body for that long, I think that's why he's having issues.
Hugh Jackman said the same thing about him, the training that he was going through to be Wolverine, and the fact that they need to be dehydrated before movies.
Yes.
Yeah.
Kind of didn't help to do the degeneration of his skin problem.
It's also your brain. Like I found out, like the statins, like Pravastatin and shit like that, it's actually really bad for you. You know, because it does. Here's the deal, like. The medical industry and their infinite wisdom or on the side of the drug companies, right?
Right.
So your cholesterol levels originally, it was originally marked at like 300, 320 or something like that, right? But they have to sell more drugs. They lowered the level to like 200.
There is a reason why the strongest men are never lean as hell. Right. Dude, it's one of the things I noticed when I started doing weightlifting, when I did the Montreal Olympics and stuff like that, I was doing weightlifting competition. And I was curious to what's the difference, right? Why? And started training, and then you look at those fit people, and then you see those big motherfuckers coming in, right?
Yeah, but
and
the deal is
they don't have as much muscle showing, but they outperform all of them.
Yep. Well, that's because bodybuilding is just for show. You know, and that shit's worse than anorexia.
That's my point. Voice ripping and like the professional wrestlers. Why do you think those guys are really jacked guys?
When you do strongman training, you have to eat like 12 eggs in the morning. You're going to eat 4 plates of fucking spag for fucking lunch.
Yeah.
Like it was fucking insane.
Yeah. And then if you like, you know, I mentioned before, you know, talking about like Italian movies. The fucking, if you like, what's his face? Not Reg Park. The guy that was like the first Italian Hercules, right? He was a bodybuilder.
Oh, yeah. I remember that. Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. He was a early bodybuilder, that's to say, pre-steroids. And if you look at these guys compared to like dudes that, I mean, I remember going to the gym and you'd see like these Guidos. Basically going into the gym
Was that Primo Carnera that you're talking about?
Steroids didn't exist before World War II, from what I understand, because right. steroids was invented by the Nazis to give to the soldiers
right.
to make them Ubermen.
You have to forgive me. I'm ADD as fuck today. But the guy would like, you know, eat like a horse to get really, really big. And then when he was on the set, would show up every day with a lunch pail with one lettuce inside of it. Can you imagine that?
One piece of lettuce?
Like, and everybody else, it's an Italian crew. Everybody's fucking cooking for fucking lunch and shit. And you're there with like a sad little fucking one leaf of lettuce. Yeah, no, it's not healthy. It's not healthy.
No, dude, it's terrible.
That fucking back that huge, because you're still putting a strain on your heart. Your heart doesn't care. I mean, your heart doesn't care.
Well, most of those guys have to have hip replacements, you know, and shit like that, because there's no lubrication going on there. You know what I'm saying? Like, your body needs like fats, dude.
It does. And there's good fat and there's bad fat. Well, I eat a lot of fucking nuts. Hot, salty, chocolatey.
Salty nuts.
No, I eat a lot of pistachios and cashews and shit like that. There's good fat, avocado, all that crap.
Avocado is good.
Talking about diet.
You know, one of my favorite things I used to eat a lot when I train, which I'm eating right now, is jerkies.
What, beef jerky?
Yep.
Yeah. No, that's good too. I don't eat a lot of meat. Yeah, that's pretty much the only meat that I do eat now that I think of it.
I used to eat that a whole bunch, dude. It was like my meat candy when I used to work out.
Meat candy. That sounds like a great name for a heavy metal record.
It's what I call jerkies and bacon, my meat candy.
I love bacon. Bacon's actually better for you than turkey bacon.
Yep.
That fake shit.
Oh, I can't do it. Pigs are too fucking cute, man. I can't fucking eat them. They're just too fucking
aggressive. No, I've always said, dude, if I have to go kill my own food, I'd starve to death.
Yes.
Really?
Not unless it's like a squirrel or something like that.
I think it's one of the good side of having grown between the city and the country.
Yeah.
I told that story about killing a chicken once. It was like, you know, it's the entire training of take care of something. Take good care of it.
I grew up on a farm.
Yeah. Now kill it because we're gonna cook it.
When I was younger, my dad actually got us a cow, like a calf, to raise, right? Fed it with a bottle, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
About a year later, he was hamburger. You know?
Oh my God.
He disappeared and we're like, hey, where's you know? And then he's like, well, I brought him to go get slaughtered. I was like, what? And I left a bad taste in my mouth after that, dude. Because I gotta tell you, like, before that, like you'd say, what do y'all want to eat? Chicken. Okay, pick one. And then shoot it. You know, and that would be dinner. And I was cool with it. But
when, you would shoot a chicken?
Once you,
that's a natural way to give. I mean, you know,
once you kill something, like that's raised, and you had like
hunting bond makes more sense. Hunting makes more sense.
Well, hunting's different. You don't have a bond with a deer.
Not you know? Really you just, when you think about it. It's even more cruel.
That's like killing your dog.
It depends how you see it. Hey, he's just out there minding his own fucking business, and bang, you kill it.
Yeah. Yeah.
But you don't have a bond with it.
Especially like dogs. The people that I know that have like actual experience with pigs will tell you that they're awesome animals, that they're like really, really, really cool. One of them saved fucking George Clooney's life. George Clooney.
And they taste
would be very dead, ladies, if it wasn't for his pet pig that like rousted him out of bed like before an earthquake. Leveled his fucking home.
Awesome. I don't know. That's the chicken. We just break their necks.
Yeah. No. That's cool. Like, I never judge anybody for any of this shit, right? But just for me, it's just like I'm mostly a pescatarian. I'll take a good piece of fish over anything.
We need each type of people. That's all I said. Like, you know, out of my friends, right? I'll be the one going to kill the pig and making bacon.
Oh no! It ain't gonna be me, bro.
As I'm saying, I'd be the one. I don't care.
I'll be the one going. Look at that feast.
You want some chicken? Hey, where's Paul?
Y'all
want
some of this? Oh no!
Y'all want some of this venison jerky? Cause we got some for you.
Oh, venison. Oh, venison, dude.
Oh, venison's really good for you.
Venison is really fucking good. Last time, actually, I didn't have it. I remember going with my girlfriend from just like 10 years ago. We're at a restaurant and they had venison on the fucking menu. Right. And I was like, you've got to have the venison. If you've never had venison before, you've got to have the fucking venison.
And you have to actually add olive oil to it.
It's really good. Cook it
because it's so lean. You know,
it's very good. It's very good. Yeah, deers, they're gorgeous. Whenever I see them, and we've got lots of them out here in the Hudson Valley, you got to drive slow at night, especially like on those wooded roads. Right. But, you know, and I see them, they're adorable. And I'm like, hi, babies, you know, but if the shit goes down, sorry.
Deer's different. Deer's way different.
If the shit goes down, I can sit on the back deck with a crossbow and take one out of the day.
Yeah. But I mean, raising an animal is way different than going ahead and getting in the woods and shooting an animal. You know what I'm saying?
100,000 times. It depends. Yeah. I'm sorry to hear that you went through that. It's
no, crazy. No. It's all part of life. But I mean, it's.
I get it.
It was just it was a learning experience too. Because
I don't see it as worth, because you take care of it. It's like giving back to nature that you're about to eat. You're taking care of it and giving it the love that you did. It's like the people that pray to give thanks to God for the food that they got. That's how I see it. I took care of it. I loved it. It was fucking fed. It was fat as fuck. Okay, now it's time for it to go into my plate.
Yes, yes, yes. No, no,
I have to admit, the first time.
That I respect. The first fucking time
was harsh.
I used to actually feed the chickens
pigs. Chickens, maybe.
Well, I used to feed the chickens tons of garlic and oregano because, you know, right before we killed them, I wanted that meat to be.
I know that Gerard Depardieu, he said that when
it's like,
when
it's like your version of marinating.
Gerard Depardieu. I know Sim knows who the fuck Gerard Depardieu is. I don't know about you other motherfuckers. Right?
The guy that fled to Russia because he tax evasion in France.
Yeah. It was like in a billion movies in the '80s.
He played Obelix in Asterix and Obelix.
Oh God! Hey, he was in a lot of shit. He was in a really good TV adaptation of The Count of Monte Cristo.
Oh yeah, dude, he was what was the name?
A Green Card with
in the Three Musketeers.
That's what I remember.
Porthos.
It was Porthos. Yeah.
It's so sad that that's such a shitty movie. Because you've got fucking Depardieu playing fucking Porthos, which is like
I enjoyed it.
Amazing.
Like, I'm a fan of the original, but I still enjoyed it for what it was.
I like all the Three Musketeers movies, even the super old one. I like them all.
The Man in the Iron Mask. I just thought like the director just did not know how to make a movie. That's how I felt. The original story, of course, fucking fantastic. I love me. Some fucking Dumas. That guy is like one of the great storytellers. One of the great. He's not regarded as a pulp writer, but he was a fucking pulp writer.
Yeah.
And I like he's one of my biggest influences. Really, like him and I would say.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of Musketeers.
He was a black dude too. I think his mother was Haitian. And it's funny because you see these pictures of him, and he's got. And it's just like. But looks like a white guy sitting there, but with like an afro.
Yeah. He was light skinned.
With a big grin on his face. I love looking at pictures of artists, right? Because then you're looking to see like, you know, what kind of a person is this, right? Like Lovecraft and Bradbury, they were guys that evidently had these eyes that when you looked into them, you were like looking into the eyes of like a 15-year-old. And what the fuck? How the fuck did we get on this from Gerard Depardieu about to fucking kill a fucking turkey?
That's what we do, man. We
get I know, I get it. It's the meanderings and all that where you in the confusion where you get the good stuff, where you find it.
It's the Harbor Farms. You can blame it on the Harbor Farms.
Anyway, I know everybody watching, I apologize to you for this conversation. We should be talking about the bride. I get it. But we do what we do because we give zero fucks. But yeah, the producer said that when he kills a turkey in his restaurant, evidently he has or had a restaurant, that he would like, speak very calmly to it, you know, make sure it was nice and chill, very, very nice and calm, and then snap its neck. Because he said, like, you don't want the animal to be stressed out because you're going
to... I remember on a farm, my two little brothers were up against a fence post, and they each had a basket of quail, and they were taking a quail and slapping their heads on a fence post, twisting them and throwing them in a bucket. You know? Well, it was dinner. You had to eat.
No, I get it. No. Look, understand, I'm a pussy. Okay?
And I'm like, well, I grew up in the suburbs. Doing
that. Dude, you've seen the Brady Bunch? That was kind of like, that's where I lived. I still had managed to have a hellish childhood somehow. But yeah, no, I'm soft as fuck. Although I lived in the city for a bunch of years, that makes you hard, but it makes you hard in like a different way. It makes you, and that's why also I'll never move back to like a big city. It makes your heart hard, and that's not
good. Really? I'm going to be in and out a little bit because I'm cooking at the same time. So I just want to let you know. So if I don't answer some things because I'm cooking, I'll be back.
It's all good. It's all good, man.
And if I just suddenly disappear, it's because my internet went, fuck you, Pop.
Look, as long as I don't have to fucking hang here and vamp by myself, I am like a very happy man.
If I have to disappear, it's because of aliens.
Oh my God, that movie fucking No One Will Save You. How great was that?
No one will save
you. Yeah, yeah. Everybody, if you haven't seen, if you're sleeping on that, check that out. That's an excellent, excellent
movie. That hit me from left field. I was like, wow. I was like, this is crazy.
And dude, show don't tell.
Yeah, there's not a single
line of dialogue in that entire movie.
That was crazy, dude. It was good. I like it.
Yeah, I absolutely love that to pieces. But you see, that's the thing that's great about horror. Horror as a genre is the only genre that I can think of that goes well with everything, right? Yeah. You mix horror with costume drama. That would be the bride here. That's how I would define this movie. It's like a horror costume drama, right? It goes well with comedy, right? Evil Dead 2, Brain Dead, Dead Alive, Shaun of the Dead. It goes well with fucking with science fiction, Alien. And, you know, my God, how many great fucking sci-fi horror movies have we had? It doesn't matter. It's like Sriracha or something like that. It goes with everything. This scene is like a standout for me, right? Because what you can see here happening is the process of the monster, right? Everything has gone horribly wrong. His mate has fallen into the hands of his creator, fucking Frankenstein, and he is now once again just kind of unmoored and by him, alone in the world. And he's walking through the woods, and he looks up because he hears a bird, and then for a moment, it's like he turns into Karloff's monster, right? Where he goes, oh, bird, right? And this is the aspect of the monster that is from Shelley, right? Like if you remember from the novel, you've read Frankenstein, right? Or listened to the audiobook?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Remember when he first, when he's relating a story to Frankenstein in the cave, the monster talks about like when he left the house, how he was like wandering through the forest and just like appreciating the beauty of nature. Yeah. Right? That's like that aspect of the monster. And then what's so great here is that for a moment he's like transported by beauty. And then you see his expression, and then that joy is gone and he's back to being the fucking Frankenstein monster. It's a moment that, folks, if you watch this movie, you definitely should fucking keep your eye out for. Go ahead.
There's no old man in this movie, right? The dwarf takes that role. Am I right about that?
Because check this out. Because the blind man was earlier in the story.
Okay.
Right? Because this movie basically begins where The Bride of Frankenstein ends.
Ah, okay. Because I was wondering, I was like, is there a part one to this? Did I miss a part one or something?
That's one of the things I love about this fucking movie.
Yeah.
Because it's like that. It's like a part two or a part three. It's like a sequel, but you kind of know where you're at if you know your Frankenstein.
Yeah.
If you don't know your Frankenstein, if you haven't seen the original movies,
you might be a little lost.
You're gonna be a little bit lost. Oh, that's another thing that we should talk about too tonight, at least really quickly. The fucking Universal monster movies are free right now.
Really?
Yes. They. If you know anything about Universal, they have been real fucking assholes with the Universal monsters ever since VHS came along. They lost a generation of fucking fans that way. Little kids, most of the millennials and shit that I know, they've never seen these fucking movies. They've never seen the original Frankenstein or Bride of Frankenstein or the Wolfman or the Invisible Man or any of that shit.
I remember
shit out there for free. Hopefully people will start to fucking discover. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, I bought my Universal Monster movies like years and years ago when they had them on DVD at it was Walmart or something like that. Right. And when DVD started to be phased out, I just ripped it. You know, I don't know if that's legal or not, but I mean, I bought it. I don't know why I should lose it just because they decided to change format.
Dude, I am an internet pirate. That's why I swear I will never bitch or moan about somebody ripping my comic and putting it online for free, right? Because if I bitch about that, I'm the biggest fucking hypocrite. Here's my attitude towards file sharing. And I'm actually sincere about this. For me, it's no different than back in the Disney when I would get like the new Slayer record and I'd be like, yo, dude, did you hear the new Slayer? No, dude. I got it. And then I would make you a fucking rip. And maybe you would make a rip of like the new Celtic Frost record. Do you know what I'm saying?
Oh, we used to do that all the time. I don't see
it as any different than that.
Damn, it's
it does.
We got people popping up in the chat. I was over here sleeping. What's up, Robin?
I'm trying.
Yeah, you're right. They do. It's just, I mean, I didn't feel like buying them every Halloween, so...
No, well, I mean, unless it's something special like a restoration that has like new scenes, right? Thank God the copy of Frankenstein that we have, you know, the original James Whale movie, that scene where he throws the little girl into the pond, that was cut from that movie and lost for about 50 fucking years. Like a really long fucking time. And now it's been restored. And every time you watch it now, it's the restored version, which is cool. What's going on in the chat? Everybody in the chat, thank you for hanging out. We do appreciate you. Chris, my boy, my bizoy. If you're out there, if you're watching, listening, much love to you. I was about to say a bad word because he's like one of those friends that you say like the worst insults to.
I come in and you change the image and go, hey, it's the Kurgan.
Young Clancy Brown, man. Young Clancy Brown. And also the people's Lex Luthor.
What?
The People's Lex Luthor.
People.
Martin Clancy Lex Brown. Luthor. He was he did the voice of Lex Luthor for the Warner Brothers cartoons for 5 years.
All of them?
Yes.
Okay.
That's true.
I know that he did, but I thought it was just for one or two movies. Like,
No.
But he also did Mr. Krabs for
Spongebob. Oh yeah, I can't hear you. Yeah, that's Clancy Brown. Yeah, no, the dude's a fucking legend.
Yep.
For sure. This, by the way, is not Jennifer Beals. This is a body double. For some reason, she didn't want to do this scene where she's walking about nude, but her body is kind of covered by shadows. Although you do get a very nice look at her muffin, which makes me think that Jess Franco must have really loved this movie, because Jess Franco is the Spanish horror movie director who, like, you know how some guys are like breast men, butt men, leg men. Jess Franco, vagina man. Seriously, man, that's just where his camera goes. There's a naked woman like in his camera. Yeah, and so Eva is the name of the bride in this, and she comes downstairs butt naked because she doesn't know that that's like not that's not a thing to do in polite society. It's not a nice thing to do in Elizabethan England. So she comes
so
to
it's
him.
Adam and Eve.
Right. He's like, I'll name you after the first woman. Oh yeah, here's where they go for a pint, a pint and a pail, and get dumped in the river for their mischief.
I didn't get to watch that movie.
It's really good. The link is down in the description, and
I told myself I was gonna go find it somewhere else, but I totally forgot.
Dude, do you have a VPN?
Yes, I have the Google one, but didn't work.
Okay. Yeah, sorry everybody. If you're not aware, Sim isn't from real America. So
America.
You know. I'm from the Great White North, which is better.
Yes.
Yeah, from America.
No, we love our Kanuckistanian.
Sorry, but you put me on the spot. I had to.
No, I know.
I have to stand my fucking ground.
You gotta represent.
America.
I step to you. You gotta fucking. Gotta represent.
Take off, eh?
No, look, much love to our fucking Canadian neighbors. Much love to our fucking Mexican neighbors. I wish we behave a little more differently towards each other.
One of the guys that I play DDO with live online sometimes, Doran, he lives up there. Whitefire Comics, he lives up Canada.
Yeah, man. And David Cronenberg is from Canada, and fucking the Trailer Park Boys are from Canada.
Talk about our friends.
Goldenberry, like there's a whole bunch of people that you guys admire that come from here. Yeah.
I'm talking about our friends. I don't care about the Trailer Park Boys.
A buddy of mine did the cover for their comic. And
for what?
I'm gonna bring up the
had a Trailer Park Boys comic.
If it's just comics, John Byrne, Tom McFarlane, Del Keon. Let me to continue.
Oh my god! Yeah,
no, McFarlane's is Canadian.
Who?
Todd McFarlane. McFarlane's Chris, a Canadian.
Chris, if that was you calling me, sorry, I'm doing a live stream right now, bro. I don't know if he was just calling me to fuck with me. Also, don't pirate from indie creators. My guy's had his comic pirated so much. If it had been sales, he could have bought a house. Here's the thing. I don't think that that's an issue. Now, would I pirate somebody else's shit? No, of course not, right?
You see, comics are different, though.
Pirated, I'm all for it. Because here's the thing. Our audience, the people who buy books from us, they're book people. They're not digital people. I think I always have a digital tier for all of my books because some people don't live here in the United States, shocker, and they love comic books and they don't want to pay $28 for fucking shipping and handling.
Well, also, right? Comics, like if somebody really likes a comic, they'll go ahead and buy it because it's collector's
Sorry, I froze there for some reason.
Man, they send me PDFs all the time. When I sit in this chair, I'm working. I don't have time to read comics.
Oh, yeah, I ain't got time either. That's
real quick. Fuck all you guys.
Real quick, fuck all of us.
Real quick, fuck all you guys, because oh yeah, check it out. Deadly Hands of Kung Fu.
That's Iron Fist. That's not Kung Fu.
I got something to show you, Brian. I got something to show you. Look what I'm reading right now. I want you to look at the name. The name down there.
Oh yeah.
I love Jim Starlin, but he did lose a lot of cred with that fucking Dreadstar shit he put out.
Andy Smith.
Yeah, love that. Love that too.
Andy Smith did the inks in this, dude.
That's awesome.
And this is kind of different. I don't know if you guys know about this.
Well, it's all nice and shiny. It's like embossed.
Dude, this book is, I mean, the story, it's different. It's a Thanos.
Is that the new shit? Story. Is that the new shit?
This is, I don't know, got to be 10, 15 years old.
Oh, okay. Because you know that fucking...
new shit's garbage.
Look.
I don't buy anything new, you know that.
Yeah, what's the point? But yeah, Preston and I are going to be doing so like smart. A martial arts.
I need my glasses before I can tell you what year this is.
I was, you know, one of the movies that inspired me to contact one of our mutual friends about doing a martial arts book was Ninja Assassin. Did you see that one? It's really not an old movie. It's more of a newer.
Oh,
newer
no, it's movie. A, it's a very new movie. I mean, like the last like 10, 15 years. Yeah, it was produced by the Wachowski brothers. Here's the thing that's great about ninjas, right?
10 years old.
What we know about ninjas can fill a thimble. So if you're a writer, you can make anything up. And that's exactly what they did in that. The ninjas have like supernatural powers. They're like these great moments where they seem to like literally melt into the shadows.
Yeah. Well, that's what you, I love we kind of grew up thinking ninjas were, you know what I'm saying? Because there's always this mysticism, you know, a ninja can do anything. So everybody wants to be a ninja whenever you were playing around in the schoolyard. They kind of did that and they made it, you know, it's almost like they took Kung Fu Theater and they just made a big movie called Ninja Assassin out of it. Yeah. Dude,
Henry Sonata is in that fucking, and then of course you've got fucking the villain is Shokasugi, who was the ninja guy in those during the 80s. Mr. Bracey says puts it exactly right. Ninja Assassin is a gory comic book movie, basically.
Oh, hell, it is so good. Yes,
that's exactly it. I loved it. I thought it was absolutely
Yeah, that's one of the movies that inspired me to go ahead and want to do like reminded me of how great kung fu movies were back in the day. Yeah.
Oh my God! Thank God they made a million of them.
Yeah.
Right. It's one of the same thing with the Italians. It's just like, oh man, there's no more Italian horror. They stopped making horror movies. Oh shit, the Italians stopped making westerns. It's okay because for the 10 years that they did, they made a billion of them.
Yeah. Exactly. And so.
We're good.
And YouTube is flush with them too. Like they got one. I'm getting ready to check out. It's called Death Rides a Horse with Angel Eyes. Yeah.
That's one of the 10 best. That's one of the 10 best. As a matter of fact, I was thinking of maybe doing that next week for Spaghetti Western Jamboree.
Yeah.
Or Four of the Apocalypse, which is like by Lucio Fulci, the horror director. And it's like a Western, but it's got like cannibalism in it.
The Thanos book is from 2014.
Gotcha. That was like right before the fucking Wokening.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I know, right? It was right before all that shit like took off.
In comics, because the Wokening started in 2012.
Yeah.
Video games and movies.
Yeah. Yeah. If you count Gamergate, I suppose.
Yep. But I counted. I was part of it. I was in university.
I know. I know.
Didn't Gamergate like start the whole thing?
Mm-hmm.
Didn't that start the whole like take over comics? Because that's
yeah, that's the entire thing. That, you know, that first thing was Gamergate. Gamergate was fighting the game and the movie industry, because there's the movie gate too that people forgot about that was right before Gamergate.
Right. Yeah, and you know, that's the thing. It's like,
except the gamer stood their ground for everything.
Well, I mean, the thing is nobody fucking, you know, people always had the attitude, well, let them come for your shit because they're never gonna come for my shit.
Mm-hmm.
That's, you know, why
the funny thing is, Beacon and I, when we became friends, it was like in the beginning of CG and stuff like that, right?
Yeah.
And he was like, dude, I was part of Gamergate. I go, me too. He goes, really? I never saw you there. Yeah, I was under Nomus 7. He goes, holy shit, I remember seeing you.
Wow. Internet is like the coolest thing ever, man. Yeah. It really is. You know, that you can fucking, that we can be in different parts of the world and be hanging out and having a conversation. Oh,
dude, I remember university.
I never take that shit for granted, dude.
If you stood your ground or you try and defend some people, like I had to defend my female animation teacher, because she dared to say that it was going to be a big gala and it was going to be a high heels and tie night.
Mm-hmm.
And the three fucking teachers, male, by the way, right?
Uh-huh.
That work at Ubisoft.
Yeah.
Started berating her, saying she was a fucking sexist for asking a woman to wear high heels.
Well, I mean, they kind of have a point.
Well, wait a second. She was asking her to wear
You want to start with this?
I'm sorry. I'm a little baked. Could you just roll that?
She was
back?
Sexist. It's an old saying here, right? That when it's a high night, you know, like a very important, like a gala or something,
right?
It's a high heel and tie. So guys put their ties on, and girls wear their high heels, right? It's a suit and tie thing, you know, like the
formal thing. Dress, yeah. Right.
And then they started calling her and berating her, saying she's sexist to tell woman to wear high heels. It's a this, it's a that.
Are these people retarded? Wait, don't answer that question.
Yeah, so I stood up and I defended her and I actually like fucking owned them.
Of course.
One of their famous line, and you know, everybody heard that afterward, was, you know, the industry is small, right?
Motherfucker.
And we all know each other. And I'm like, right. Oh, interesting.
Yeah, it's called a threat. That's what they did to Jim Rugg.
Yeah.
And he turned his back on his buddy because of stupid shit like that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you're in comics and you write comics and you draw comics, then you always know, like, the villain's always going to take a cheap shot. You know?
That's why the villain always has the advantage.
That's why they're hoping you fold, right? Because their threats are usually empty.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. And
they try to get me kicked out of university and I fought and I won. Fuck you, I finished. Oh, dude,
Good on you, man.
They were fucking dirty.
Motherfuckers. It blows my mind because these are liberals, right? So they're like, here's the thing.
Did I consider myself a liberal too, like center liberal? And it was fucking idiotic to see those people. Go ahead.
Like,
this
people are just like, wait a second. I thought I thought you were supposed to be the smart ones, and they're like, we're going to fight fascism. Okay, I'm with you. How do you want to do that? We're going to fight fascism with fascism.
The worst thing is, let's empower women, but let's all guys here like attack women because they're sexist.
Right. Right. It's
they're bigots. You know, it's the same thing with Gina Carina or whatever.
Dude, what are you? I mean, I am.
Let's respect strong women, except the ones we don't
shit's
like.
It's gonna not look good in the history books. Do you know what I'm saying? Yep. It's not gonna look good.
Yeah,
it's not gonna look good. They're gonna
just
be
like other
people.
Shit.
But that's the thing. That's why we have to remember these people's names. Is because in fucking 5-10 years, they're gonna be like,
fuck you,
oh,
and
God, you remember that cancel culture? Oh God, that was just the
and
worst.
Fuck you, and those.
The only way that happens is if you make these people famous. You keep their names.
She was the head of the fucking entire thing we were fighting at Gamergate 2. Fucking Heather Entos, and fuck you for everything.
That's the key. What Sim just did.
Yeah.
He's naming those motherfuckers.
Yes.
That's the Alex only way any of that shit goes into the past is if you keep those motherfuckers in the spotlight.
Mm-hmm.
Right. No, it's totally true. It's totally true. Fuck those motherfuckers. They have blood on their hands.
Yes. Own fact that they've all tried to cancel me. Don't give a shit.
Well, dude, we've all been canceled.
Don't
act like there's something special about you. We've all been fucking canceled.
You gotta put that on there. I tell people, I'm like,
yeah. Dude, I'm sorry.
There was an entire anti-cancel culture movement.
There was an entire hashtag. You remember hashtag Blame Sim?
Yes, of course. You don't forget that shit. I'm not forgetting that shit around my the same ass. Time we're getting the fucking birthday stream where we all took our fucking shirts off.
Yep. Hold on, my birthday is coming soon again.
Nice. Oh shit! I need to hit the gym then. You know.
And I'm aiming. I'm doing my best to have everything ready, like Beacon's coloring the two extra pages I added.
Oh
and,
man!
And finalizing the editing, and I want to have that proof. And I would love to get that proof in my hand for my birthday. But it's depending on the
printer. You're gonna get it soon. You're gonna get it soon.
Yeah.
Oh, but that's a special moment when you get that proof. Oh yep. Shit!
He's burning his house down.
Burning his house down.
He's probably it's like he's ordering out.
Fatty, and then fucking set the curtains on fire.
So much for cooking. Yep.
Uh-huh. Send me fucking stoner.
I so can't this is you up.
For pizza.
Do you guys recognize this battery out, well, young man?
The Princess Bride.
Yes, that's Carrie Elwes.
That's exactly who that is.
Yeah, which I think is like I think this was his first movie. Now in this he plays a an
officer. Sorry about that.
Back at no worries, bro.
Smoke.
Back in the era of the nobility, basically they were all doing military service because believe it or not, one of the things you had to do if you were an aristocrat, you had to go and fight. Right. If there's a war going on, you needed to fucking enlist, or someone from your family needed to enlist, right? It's a complete opposite today, right? Rich people do not fucking, they've learned their lesson. They do not do that shit anymore. But that's basically what this guy is. And the part calls for a guy that's basically pretty looking, but flat. And that's exactly what fucking Cary Elwes gives you here. I mean, he turned into a really good actor, but here he's just literally a pretty face.
He's a prop.
Well, that's the thing. Characters like this in a normal Universal horror movie, he would be the hero. He would have a little mustache and he would be the hero. And that's one of the things that I can't say that I hate, but I would say actually that I find fascinating about the old Universal monster movies is that there is always the heroine has like her love interest, right? Who's usually the monster, right? Or something like that, or the mad scientist or whatever. Then there's this like really good looking guy off to the side that looks like a male model, but has like zero personality. Like it's just like completely devoid of charisma. And you see this over and over and over and over again. So it becomes interesting where you're just like, wait a second. And that just left a huge impression on me as a kid, because one of the messages that always sent me was, these are not the interesting people. The movie's not about these. The movie's about the fucking monsters.
Sounds like my ex-girlfriends.
And naturally, of course.
But that was the magic of any big Frankenstein-related movies. The fact is that they made the monster is more human than the rest.
Well, that, yeah. You know, Brian said something the other day when we were talking about one of those Westerns. In that I've always seen Frankenstein as the villagers being the villain in Frankenstein.
Yeah, you know, of course.
That's what it is.
Especially when you're a kid, bro.
No, I don't think it is, though. Because the way Brian described it is the villagers are the world. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's the world they live in. Yeah. So I think, the more I think of it, the more I know, like, Frankenstein is just the one unique. I think the reason why it's so unique is because there is no villain. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yes.
I, I'm,
I mean, they're villainous deeds. The monster does.
There is a villain. The villain.
But does he do? The villain is
human nature.
Or,
you have the doctor. The doctor.
Frankenstein.
You have the doctor.
He strangles a little boy, murders a child, and then lets a governess.
Not this one.
Hang for
not
it.
This movie. I'm talking about the original movie. In,
I'm
black and white.
Novel. I'm talking about the novel.
I'm talking about this.
The original movie.
Novel. He actually kills people.
But the reason why he kills people is because his brain has been encoded with
violence.
It's because Fritz, is that sick fucking bastard who's played so beautifully by Dwight Frye, who played Renfield in Dracula, he fucking tortures the monster with like a whip and a fucking a torch. That's why the monster's afraid of fire. Right? And so he's abusing this child.
That's my point. The bad guy is actually human nature. You know, it's the people mistreating him.
You could say that. You could say
the doctor that doesn't know better, right?
You could say that Igor is the villain.
It's not Igor. It's
and then the villagers it's the monster within people, and that's the point of the villainy that people have trouble accepting. It's the monster within yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I totally agree with that. Like, I've always thought
they're not villains, like per se, like caricaturic type of like villain, like typical type of thing. But it's the actual normal human villain, and that's you know what I mean.
Dog's killing me.
As for Frankenstein himself, in this, it's like the Frankenstein that we get. Isn't the Universal Monsters Frankenstein, right?
It's a friendly giant,
like Colin Clive. Like he's not like flamboyantly gay for one thing, but like playing straight poorly, which was the case with Colin Clive, you know. And he had that very shrill delivery. It's alive! Oh God, now I know what it feels like. This is not that Frankenstein. This is a Frankenstein, actually, that is closer to the Peter Cushing Frankenstein in the Hammer movies. And that motherfucker, by the third movie or so, Frankenstein
was evil.
Destroyed. He's a serial killer.
Yeah, he was evil. Rapist. Fuck, dude. Yeah.
He's like totally depraved. That's the thing about the Hammer Frankenstein movies. In those, Frankenstein is the monster.
Well, in the Hammer Frankenstein films, like Hammer cranked that shit up to 11.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
Everything. Dracula, everything went up to 11.
But, and the thing is, you can see the influence of the Hammer movies in the sense that one of the things I love about this movie is how lush it looks, right? I don't think that this was a particularly expensive movie, but once again, it's a costume drama. And that was the thing that was so great about the Hammer movies was that there were gothic horror with these like amazing costumes. So they were kind of like costume dramas, but they were just these outrageous fucking fantasies. One of the things that Peter Cushing said in an interview that I found fascinating was he said he never liked to think of the movies as horror films. And he said, it's not that, you know, I'm like, ooh, I don't want that label. That we don't love like the horror fans. It's just I always felt that the movies that we were making weren't really horror, they were fantasy. But then you had these actors in there and they would be in some outrageous shit and play that shit 100% fucking straight, 100% fucking sincere. There was no winking at the fucking camera. That's one of the things I fucking hate about so much of the shit these days. It's never sincere. It's always winking at you.
Like, it reminds me of Saturday Night Live. Like they always laugh during the skits, and I'm like, well, that kind of ruins the skit, you know?
It's exactly. Ugh, God. I'll never forget when it's actually a masterclass in like what not to do. Is the Saturday Night Live where they had some of the Monty Python actors. I think they had John Cleese and, Michael Palin, I think. And they were recreating the Dead Parrot skit. right, from Monty Python's Flying Circus, which was originally hilarious, and you see them recreating it, and it was just like a fucking disaster.
Well, yeah, because you can't laugh.
Put that up if you can find it on YouTube, and it's like it's because sometimes we can learn more from disasters than we can from like things that are like flawless.
It's the same thing with those goddamn awful laughing tracks and sitcoms and shit like that. It's like they think that because it works for some people, I was gonna say something meaner, but for some people, right?
Yeah,
it will trigger them like a laugh. But to most people, it ruins the entire joke. And usually they start it when it's not even fucking funny.
Well, that's something that's actually left over from the 60s and the 70s. You know, I don't know why they still have it, but yeah, that's
why. Do they still have it?
I mean, in like sitcom, like funny sitcom. No, wait. Dude. In Modern Family, they never had it. It's like Nickelodeon shit or something like that. You know what I'm saying?
Like, you know how some people, they have certain genres that are just really not for them? To the point where they're like actively antagonistic towards them. For me, that's fucking sitcoms. Like in hell, if I go there, that's the only shit. That's the only channel I'm getting is fucking sitcoms, 24 hours a day.
Dude, I can't
never any fucking Sergio Leone. Never any fucking Hammer horror. Nothing. Just fucking old fucking Laugh Track City fucking sitcom shit for the
rest. Okay, Brian. Here's your version of hell.
Like I'm actively I find them insulting. Like I honestly say that I find most of them offensive. It's weird for because to me it's like they're offending my, they're insulting my, I feel like they insult my intelligence.
Well, while the devil was giving your verdict in hell, like there's a laugh track going on in the background. You know what I'm saying? Like,
I get the psychology, though. You know what the psychology there is, right, Sim? It's because laughter is contagious.
Yeah, I know. I get it. But
it doesn't work.
It could work when you actually time it when it's actually funny, not when it's corny.
Right. Right.
The way that people have been using that, like in Friends or other freaking sitcoms, it's just like, oh, we think that's funny. I think it's a pun, but no, it doesn't work.
Yeah, it's like they were using it trying
to reproduce a live audience.
Exactly.
And not the same reason that it was before. It's a live audience.
Like Brian said, it doesn't work. It's psychological. But it doesn't work.
You understand the idea, right?
It works when you're little and you're not intelligent. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. And it works when the timing's good. Let's just be honest. The timing is good, it will amplify your laughter.
Wait, Sammy, you're saying that if they put a laugh track on Frankenstein, you wouldn't laugh? Is that
what?
Like while the head was going, bleh, bleh, like, and they put a laugh track in the background, like you wouldn't want to laugh at.
Laugh tracks for inappropriate shit would make that would genuinely be funny.
Yes.
Or atrocities with a laugh track or something.
Oh, and that half a woman's body fell out the test tube. Like,
oh, he's choking that kid to death. Just broke his neck. Yeah, that would be kind of funny. We need to do that in a comic book. How would you do that?
Like you do that motion comic and then put a laugh track in it?
You could do it like you know, like something bad happens and then all of a sudden you put a big and somebody goes, "Where the fuck did that come from?" A bit like the Joker part, like in the Joker when he dies. And he has that little thing on him.
Yeah.
That type of thing, like, "Hey, it's that guy's phone. Ring your phone."
Goddamn. Yeah. Let's watch the trailer to The Bride because it's actually pretty good. You know what? We got to take a look at the marketing for this.
I mean, to be quite honest, it's the only thing.
I think one of the reasons why it bombed.
I didn't see the movie, but I saw the trailer, and that's what I wanted to say before, so I'll get a second to say it. When I watched the trailer, Frankenstein there gave me more the vibe of the Gentle Giant from, I forgot what the name of the actual play in the movie is, but you know, that Gentle Giant that's so... so nice, so this, but every time he tries to freaking hug something, he kills it.
Well, that was the original Frankenstein, right? Yeah, that, That's the premise from the
Boris Karloff.
Yeah.
Boris Karloff really, that character was very precious to him. And, you know, there's a reason why after the third movie, he was like, I'm out. Like, I'll be in a Frankenstein movie, but I'm not playing the monster. Right?
That's, a new
that's why he's in House of Frankenstein, but he's not the monster in that.
Yeah.
Right? The reason why the character was so important to him was because of the letters that he got, specifically from little children. Little fucking kids absolutely love the fucking Frankenstein monster. I know I did too. He's easy for a child to relate to. Right? Clumsy, misunderstood.
And a type of innocence doesn't understand certain urges. And
And of course, that's because Karloff's performance as the monster in that is incredibly tender. He's a very, out of all like the Universal monster actors, I actually think he was the most gifted.
Oh, he was the best. He was the absolute hands down. That's why I used his image as Doc Salem's image, because he was so good. You know.
Oh, the best, the best. And where's he from? Kanuckistan, from Canada.
Kanuckistan.
Yeah. Although this is really interesting. He was half Indian. And I remember thinking like, oh, he's half like Native American. No, he's half Indian. Like, his father was an Englishman that was like stationed, I think, in India when it was like a British colony. And he met his mother, they got married, and they moved to Canada. And that's where little Boris was born. Yeah, so that so when you look at Boris Karloff's face, you're just like, oh my God, he's like half Indian. That's why the gypsies are of Indian ancestry, which when I found that out, blew my fucking mind. Yeah. Now watch this and tell me if you don't think that this is like sort of pushing the whole Sting Jennifer Beals romance thing. Let me get some fucking volume on here. Oh man, the music here is so 80s. None of this is the music from the film, by the way.
He desired something beyond love.
I might make the new woman, Clavel. Independent, free, and a fit companion for
the genius of Frankenstein.
He created something beyond woman.
Beautiful.
Where did I come from?
She'll break a few hearts, will she not?
Now tell me, what kind of vibe are you getting from this? Like, what do you think that they're trying to, or do you think that they're trying to make the audience think that this is a movie that's not the movie that they ended up getting?
It did feel kind of Xanadu-ish.
Xanadu? Xanadu, motherfucker, that's the best you're going to give me is fucking Xanadu. Now we are here.
I don't know, you know, like horror back then.
Out of my head for fucking 30 years, motherfucker.
Horror back then was very corny. Like, even the music was horrible. You know, it was terrible.
Yeah.
Who is she, Charlie?
I can't take a horror movie like serious with music like that. Like, right? I can't.
Well, yeah, it doesn't mean it's like they're selling this as something that's not a horror movie.
What is she? You must obey me.
I will not obey you.
And yes, what Mr. Bracey said is true. One of the funniest misleading movie trailers is for Casualties of War, which was this Brian De Palma movie, Vietnam flick, with what's his face? The guy from Back to the Future, Michael J. Fox. If you watch, and that's a
good movie, too.
That's an amazing movie. Yeah. It's an amazing movie. It's really a great American film, right? It's about grape in war, right? How that's just a fucking, I know it's terrible. It's like we have to talk.
No, no, I was going to say Michael J. Fox, Canadian.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Oh,
you started it.
I think that's why. I think that's why you had bad genes, though.
Ain't no half stepping, man. It's this really sensitive.
You're gonna say that about him drama. And not Bruce Willis?
Well, fuck Bruce Willis.
Bruce Willis isn't even from this planet. I don't know.
Yeah, fuck that guy. But if you watch the trailer for Casualties of War, you think you're getting Rambo.
Yeah.
Like every gunshot, every explosion that's in that movie is in that fucking trailer. And so, surprise, it bombed because the audience that would have appreciated it stayed away, and the audience that they brought in were there for the movie that was in the trailer, not for the actual movie.
They used to do that way too often before. It was tending to the initial, how do you call it, clickbait?
Yeah, that's exactly what it was.
Yeah, something I'd like to add about that music there. It might be corny music, but I'd rather have that than having the next P. Diddy song or something that they've been doing right now.
P. Diddy, the D, the I, the D, the D, the Y, the P, the I, the D, it's D. What?
What the fuck is going on with that dude? Like, people are saying, like, he was trafficking or something like that?
He was sex trafficking. He abused fucking people. He slept with young boys. He met under contract. And he did a whole bunch of,
He's a fiend.
So he was just...
He's a piece of shit.
Is what he was.
Basically, he should be like under the prison.
Yep.
Like one of those dudes. Do you know what I'm saying?
That's Hollywood, isn't it? Like, isn't that?
Yeah, they get to do that. Yeah. Yeah. Although he's New York based, remember?
That's New York. That's your people, Brian.
Yeah. We're not accepting responsibility for that piece of shit, man. Fuck that guy.
You just selected things.
He and Vince McMahon should be put in like a pit and forced to fight to the death.
Vince McMahon.
And the winner gets to get like torn apart by fucking
What did Vince McMahon do?
Yeah, what did Vince McMahon do?
Oh my God. Really, really bad. Really.
I know that he really did a fucking true job and fucked over.
He's a murderer.
Bret Hart.
He's a murderer. He was supplying steroids to his wrestlers.
They were killing
themselves because he had to have like these giant fucking bodies.
Okay, yeah, but they also made their choice. Like they're grown.
Here's this heroin. If you
know, it's like the people that came to me when I was doing the Montreal Olympics, and they were all trying to get me on steroids. Fuck you! I'm not doing it.
Yeah, fuck that. Fuck that. No, I get that, but here's the thing. After all wrestling became McMahon wrestling, when he bought WCW and ECW, right? And that's when I stopped watching wrestling. Because it's like, all I get is McMahon wrestling? Fuck that. That's when I stopped watching wrestling. He was basically, if you wanted a job, right? Because a lot of people were going to get lost. And you knew that like the Mexicans, the luchadors, and any of the smaller wrestlers, you were never going to see them again. And that's exactly what happened.
Rey Mysterio stayed around for a long time.
Him being the exception.
The only difference with Eddie Guerrero died. But,
you know why? Because if you look at him when he was in WCW, and then you look at him when he was in the WWF, he's twice the size.
Well, that's what I was about to say, is that Rey Mysterio is almost unrecognizable now because he's so big. He was never that big when he was with WWF.
I don't remember the name of the guy, but the guy that played Bane was a wrestler, and the same thing happened to him. He died because of all this shit.
Horrible.
He was way too fucking big.
Horrible.
Now again,
think about this.
You guys have to understand, he's a huge man, and those huge men are not meant to be thrown around like that on a nightly basis. You know,
no.
I mean,
no.
Jake the Snake said it the best. He said, "We used to take steroids because we're trying to heal. They had us wrestling almost every fucking night, dude."
Yeah. Well, that's what they did to Eddie Guerrero. They fucking jacked him up on steroids, got him like twice the size that he was before, and worked him to death. That's really what people say, that they were just fucking putting him out like every night.
Well, he said that's the greatest sin of Vince McMahon, is that he just worked his wrestlers to death.
Yeah, no, I mean, but then there's the new shit that he's accused of, which is just like really vile sex trafficking stuff.
Sex trafficking? Vince McMahon?
Yes.
Holy shit.
Basically, he's like, I own you, you're my slave, and you're going to do what I say. You're going to have to do my friends, or I'll watch my friends do you. The details are pretty fucking horrific.
Joe Rogan.
I didn't see any of that.
Bad thing I've ever heard about that guy.
Pulled up a picture of Vince McMahon, and he's like, and it showed Vince McMahon with like this 100-pound chain around his neck, you know?
Yeah.
He's like all swole up, and he's like, that's fucking grandpa.
That's why grandpa tore his quad just literally getting into a wrestling.
Well, because he's not supposed to be that big. His tendons can't handle that, you know?
Of course, but he's got to be that big. Of course, you know, I have a vendetta against him. Personal vendetta for ruining wrestling. I did.
But that's why we were asking.
Yes.
Just to make sure.
Jennifer Beals. Yes, yeah, it's just a whack trailer. The Bride. Boo on the trailer, whoever made the trailer. Yeah, that's just garbage. Which is interesting because, I'm guessing that they were like, oh, we must have like a bomb on our hands. I can make my own way now. So let's try and like mitigate the damage by making like people think that this is like something other than what it is. Now, one of the things that's also really instructive about this movie is how it deals with its politics, right? Because now as we know, everything's identity politics, right? This movie has a feminist a message to it. And it fits perfectly because of Mary Shelley,
We saw it straight in the beginning when he says, we will make a new woman. Stronger, more intelligent, more independent, yes. The perfect woman. Oh, so you have to make her get it.
Yeah, right, exactly. But here's the thing. And this is the weirdest little detail, and I never noticed it in this movie before, and it changes absolutely everything, right? There's a scene where Frankenstein says something, and he says that he's quoting Shelley, right? And she goes, no, that wasn't Shelley. He says it's Keats. And she's like, no, that was Shelley who said that. And he's like, Keats, right? And he's like, bitch, I'm right. You know, shut up. And so this is like when she gets into her rebellious stage, right? And she goes and she grabs a copy of Keats and throws it in his fucking lap. It's like, there you go, look it up. So I don't know if you guys noticed this. This is set in a world where the Shelleys exist. So that means that he's read Shelley and has almost certainly also read. This is this is Lit Geek stuff.
Right? So he's taking Shelley literally, and he's
right.
He's
so the Shelleys exist in this universe, and he's read them in their philosophies, and that is where he gets the idea, like, you know, a woman that's an equal of a man, right? And a new love, a love of equals, right? All of that's from the fucking Shelleys. Specifically also, Mary Shelley's mother, who wrote Vindication of the Rights of Women, which is like, God, like the original sort of feminist text. Understand this. People don't especially a lot of fucking chicks these days really don't understand the whole concept of women being the equals of men is really fucking new. Very fucking new. Like, literally just a couple of hundred years old. I think it's a perspective that modern women could learn from.
Now I can pay you back.
There are things you just don't understand, Eva.
What things?
I've told you enough already. You must trust me, and you must obey me.
I will not obey you! I will not!
Don't provoke me, Eva.
I will provoke you.
Right, so he's encouraged her, right, to think for herself. He's educated her, right? She knows her Keats from her Shelley, and now she's like starting to spiral out of control. What I'm wondering from you guys is, like, we know what, like, how our movies today, all our entertainment is fucking saturated with like Mary Sue feminist bullshit. What do you think about like the feminist angle in this movie? Like, does it strike you as something that's obnoxious?
No, because it wasn't widespread back then. You know what I'm saying? It was kind of like an original concept at the time.
Exactly.
Now, it's like they just want to pound it into it. You know what I'm saying? Like, no, this is, you know, you have to believe this. They were just like, hey, what about this?
The only thing is, like I said, I don't remember watching the movie, like, right. The only thing that I've noticed about older movies, watching them, it's the actual feminist was about equality and strong women, not just fucking being defiant.
Yes.
The
yes.
problem is right now it's always being stupidly defiant, and that's supposedly being empowering. No, you're a fucking idiot.
Well, honestly, that
when you're stupidly defiant. Like, you're just defined because a man told me so. Somebody else, or even a guy, put it the other way around. A woman telling me this, yeah, fuck you.
Like, well, let's put this in perspective. Like, all of this was brought on by corporations. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, for sure. Like, yo, if the women, CIA too, bro.
All of this, like, I know, like, the war to sexes, all that shit was just a byproduct of all this crap out of CIA. And in fact, the sexual revolution was brought on by beta males that were trying to get laid.
Yeah.
Like, all it is.
For sure. But
it's like
Gloria Steinem. Oh, I'm sorry, dude. I'm stepping on you.
No. I mean, I'm just saying,
the
like,
the most empowering of them are the fucking simps. And even though the strong men stand by them.
But that's weird. What I'm saying. Like, everybody wants to blame each other. Really, you should be blaming the government and the fucking the corporations for all this crap.
Dude,
like, they did
Gloria
this.
Gloria Steinem came right out and said, yeah, it was the CIA. The CIA basically said, go out, promote this shit. And here's the thing. Don't talk about class. That's the one fucking...
Yeah, that's the one thing they do not want you to talk
about class. Yeah. Just war of the sexes, war of the sexes. That's it. Don't talk about gender. Do not fucking talk about class. If you talk about class, we're coming for that.
See, that's another thing too. That's one thing that always got me, right? Like, even the riots that we had within the last couple of years, you know, like, it's politicians did this. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
Like, they orchestrated all of this.
Yes.
But instead of going to the politicians' houses, they go to their local supermarkets. They go to their local, like, their
idiots.
And attack their neighbors.
But, you know, I don't think it's their idiots. I think it's all orchestrated. Like, I think there's plants. You know what I'm saying? Like, people are like, yeah, let's go. Like, they get people in there with a lot of charisma to convince all these dumb shit to go ahead and destroy their neighborhoods.
Like the January 6th guy. Fucking,
Jeff Bezos is the only one that's making out like a bandit.
The guy, but the Ray Epps, that's the guy that was just like, hey, everybody, we're going to go storm the Capitol. And all the protesters around him start going, Fed.
Yeah.
Right? And then he's the one guy that doesn't go to fucking prison.
That's what
it just fucking bitch.
And it just shows how sheepish people are, because instead of realizing, like, you know, instead of saying, hey, let's go destroy Cousin Tom's bakery. No, they're not going to do that. You know, like, instead of saying like, let's go to the fucking senator's house or something like that, because he's like a couple of blocks over in a rich neighborhood.
Yep.
They won't do that. They'll go and destroy their cousin's like bakery or something like that. And then they're like, oh, that's so sad. You know, like
burn your own shit down.
Yeah. Then they're like, well, now we got a food desert. What the fuck did we do? It's government's fault. No, motherfucker, it's your fault. Like, you did this.
Well, yeah, but then you're talking about like personal responsibility and accountability, and nobody's accountable for shit these days.
Because I won't have it.
You won't have it.
Yeah, this is the great dramatic revelation where Eva finally discovers that he literally made
won't have it. Who do you think you are?
You know, it's one of the things that's one of the things I think is fucking annoying. Like I said again, it's stupidly defiant. Like, I'm sorry, we all grew up, we all know that, you know, that usually the one that runs the fucking house always the fucking lady. The guy would listen to his fucking wife or his lady for certain things, and the other way around, it was a respect thing. It was, you know, you're the strong one, you're this, you know better about this, you know better about managing money, so I will shut the fuck up.
Yes!
As a married man, I can absolutely say that I do not run my household.
Oh shit, dude.
No, dude, it's to each their own.
Well, it's just like when it comes to like business, it's like I know I suck at business, right? So leave that to my friends that are much better, more business.
Well, it's like I'm not going to pick the color of the curtains, or I'm not going to decorate the house or anything. If I decorated the house, everything would be like, it would look crazy. Like a crazy person lived here.
It would look like an underground comic, like zapped.
It'd be crazy, dude. Like there would be shit with guns hidden in it, because just in case, you know. Or
oh my god,
you know. Or there would be like swords on the wall, and you know, like a severed fucking dragon head somewhere. I guarantee you, it'd be like a dragon head somewhere in this.
Oh my god, dude! Oh,
and then there'd also be like secret passages. Like I'd have like a door that goes nowhere and shit.
For sure, dude. I mean, that's one of the things I love about this scene is, oh yeah, that's another thing too. He has like a bunch of secret entrances, and one of them is this little cubby hole he goes into to smoke what at first I think looked like opium, right? But afterwards, I've come to think that it was actually hash, that he's smoking hash oil or something like that. Like, where is that? I'm pretty sure I have a pic of that.
It's fucking Sting, so it's probably hash oil.
Probably hash oil.
Yeah. Probably. This little chamber that he has.
It's probably dried out dead babies is what it is that he's.
See the little pipe? Because I'm thinking, oh, it looks like an opium pipe. I'm like, oh, it could also be hash, though. And I'm thinking, in the next scene, he's hovering over her bed, right? And looking up
her,
like, sexual desire, thinking that could not possibly be fucking opium. Because if it was opium, he'd be fucking nodded out.
Probably black rhino horn or some shit like that. All right, it's getting late, and I got to get out of here. You guys take it easy.
Right. All right, we're gonna wrap up soon. Thanks for hanging out, Preston. Oh man. Oh, yeah. Let's see. Do
I have any? I was gonna say talking about the lady she called.
What was that?
So you was talking about the lady she called.
Oh, okay. Hey, look, I don't want to cause Preston no woman trouble. You know, I don't. God. I remember there was this guy I knew who was a Mormon, and I mean like Mormon, like Utah Mormon, right? Guy I worked with, he had three wives, and everybody was just like, oh man, that must have been so fucking hot. He eventually left with like his original wife just to leave that whole cult life behind, right? But the guys were like, oh, so you had like three wives, you had three women. Oh my God, that must have been so hot. And he was like, you know what? It fucking sucked. There's one thing that you do not want to experience in this life. It's having three women mad at you all at the same time. I was just like, oh, yeah, that doesn't sound like it would be much fucking fun. And then their periods were all fucking synced up too. Jesus, man.
Especially if they have no respect for you.
Oh, God. Yeah, no, respect is absolutely essential.
Yeah, that's the thing. I mean, that's like you know, that's why I keep bringing it up. It's all about respect. You're being stupidly defiant. It means a lack of respect. And if you're looking at what's happening now, there's no respect between the girls and the guys. There's no respect for elders. There's no respect for the youth. There's no respect for nothing.
I know. It's tragic. It really is.
So the you know, it's like a parent needs to respect the fact that their kids are young and remember how they were stupid when they were that age, and vice versa. We're supposed to help each other. It's the same thing by men and women. You know, a woman is better at some at things, and they're supposed to be completing each other. It's not typical. It's not everybody's the same. Doesn't apply to the same. It's just you will find a woman that will complete you. That was the entire fucking shtick to it. And then when you do well, you will trust her to take charge and do what she needs to do and get done. And you will do your part, and she will rely on you to do so. That this entire fucking defiant thing is fucking idiotic. That's why related women are fucking dying miserable, not having fucking kids. Thinking that they're queens and countries or whatever, like, dude.
Guys are fucking like.
It's like, guys, stop telling your little girls while they're growing up that they're princesses because they end up acting like them.
You don't want that.
And it's the same thing the other way around. Okay.
Yep. Well, I mean, it's when you it's shocking. Look at the numbers of like young men. In their like early, like late teens, early 20s, they're not fucking, man. They're not getting laid by and large. It's horrific. Saying,
Mr. Bracy there saying, watch Shogun. Dude, you don't even need to watch like the samurai. Yeah, there's the Vikings, very matriarchal type of thing. Like they were the guys, they were going there. The one at home was the lady, and the guy could fucking rape and pillage. Yeah, but if he fucking hid something from his wife, money or having another wife. Dude, yeah. He was fucking berated by every other fucking man, and he was fucking digging a fucking hole, and they had to fucking, dude, it's fucking insane. Like, it's the entire fucking spiel is fucking idiotic. Dude, we've been surviving for thousands of years
because of this shit. I know.
But no. Patriarchy is bad. Fuck you. We've been living in the matriarchy here.
I wouldn't call this a matriarchy.
There's never been a matriarchy in history,
if I'm not mistaken, right?
Dude, what does a matriarchy mean?
Well, a matriarchy means, you know, obviously not like, you know, like a queen or something like that, divine right and all that stuff. I mean, like a genuinely matriarchal society.
Women are treated as specials. They save the woman and the children first.
I mean,
who runs the house?
I mean, what I'm saying is there's never really been a matriarchy.
Yes.
Except in myth, except for the Amazons, who weren't real, of course.
In the kitchen.
Is that Alex?
She was wondering why I was yelling.
About women specifically. Oh, God.
No.
Yeah, but I mean, but here's the thing. Women are worried? Their own worst enemies. No. Right? I don't know anybody that like dislikes women more than other women. Have you ever been like walking down a street and
that's the point?
And another woman walks by and they're like,
that's the point. Women dislike women like it's oh, dude,
yeah.
It's like there was a joke in fucking Family Guy. There was a joke in Family Guy where, you know, Princess Leia's alone and she goes, "Who's that?" And they go like, "Oh, it's I don't know, Queen something. She's the only other female in Star Wars. I hate her."
Look, man.
They're more competitive and mean amongst themselves than anybody else. It's one of the things that also happened.
Like, we're holding them back. They're their own worst enemies. They're holding themselves back.
There was a woman. There was a feminist writing about, you know, empowering shame and this like that for the women and shit like that. And it goes, did you ever study men, you know, thing about the shame and the thing about men? She goes, I don't study men. It goes, oh, and the answer goes, oh, that's, how do you say, that's advantageous type of thing, you know, like, goes, what do you mean? But you see, you know, the girls, my wife and my daughter that you just signed the books for, yeah, well, they would rather see me die on my white horse than fall.
Yeah.
Like throughout the years, you're telling us to fucking open up. to show our fucking weaknesses.
Oh,
and
dude.
We get berated. We get destroyed for it. We get laughed at. And not by men.
I know. You've definitely been grooving on like that Dax video. For sure. That song. It's hard to be a man. Mm. Yeah. No, I'm not a father, so I don't totally relate. Right? I'm not married. So I can't totally relate. But I see it. Right? I see it in my friends who are married and have kids and families and stuff like that. You see it for sure. And yeah, it's a society.
Right now, there's special treatment, dude. When my point is, dude, it's one of the things that I've learned a while back doing the men's right thing and the red pill thing.
Yeah.
The thing is, dude, when I say that we technically live in a matriarchal thing, and people are like, "Yeah," and like, dude, women get half their sentence in anything law wise, they get half the men's sentence.
I know.
There's special treatment. If you're going to divorce, I don't even want to get into it. I'm one of the lucky ones that won.
I know.
Dude.
I know. I know.
It's fucking insane.
You've been through some shit, and you're a warrior. And, kudos to you and your brother for raising your kids, because that cannot be easy.
One
kid would be enough of a handful.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? But it all turned out all right.
Like I always said, kids are a gift to us.
Yes, they are. And not just to you. Not just to you too. Because I got to like experience
You will never be a true man without having kids. And I don't say that lightly.
No, I believe you. I believe you. Yeah,
it humbles you.
I have not received that blessing yet in my life. Maybe I still.
Yeah. But the thing is, dude, being a father doesn't mean having to have the kids of your own. It means taking care of.
No. Dude. Like you're talking about being a father, not a fucking sperm donor. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I have a friend who started dating a woman that was like a single mother, and he didn't just fall in love with her. He fell in love with the kid. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? That's why when a guy is dating a woman with a kid, that's really a dangerous area for a man's heart.
On your potatoes.
Yes, I want to give him my potatoes. Thank you.
Potatoes?
Oh, we're joking around. Potatoes?
I like cereal.
Potatoes?
Did you ever see that was the Home for Imaginary Friends? Foster's Home for Imaginary Friends.
Mm.
Fuck it.
Yep.
I like cereal. I like potatoes. Yeah, sorry people. That's like I'm getting mad crazy cryptic. Anyway,
well, you know me and Alex, we always mess around with that.
Yeah. Which is a cool thing. You are a lucky man, for sure. Everybody, we've been going
they're the 2 sunshine hours of my life.
What was that?
I said they are the sunshine of my life.
Are you getting like limp wristed on us?
What do you mean?
That's just I'm just fucking with you.
I don't do that. I'm just saying it's like
you're giving the feels. I'm receiving the feels.
What I mean by that, it's simple. When you feel down, you feel hard. You get thing. I think of them, and I will fucking thrive. I will fucking keep going. I will not stop. I grind, and I will never stop because of them.
Hell yeah. Hell yeah, bro. Hell yeah. We're about 2 hours. I'm thinking next week. We're going to be doing the Spaghetti Western Jamboree. I'm thinking either, Four of the Apocalypse by Lucio Fulci or, Death Rides a Horse with, Lee Van.
Let me know in advance. So I can try and find them. I like to watch those movies before the stream. Like I didn't get to watch this one, but I was a bit busy this week.
And I'm not going to wait like to fucking Wednesday to drop that shit. I'm going to
please.
drop that shit as ASAP. As,
like, you know, the last Western, I finished it like 5 minutes before you started the
stream. I know. I remember. Anyway, Sim, tell everybody where they can find you and what you got coming up.
You can find me on the any social media under Simon Sim Poitier or just Sim _ Inkslayer. You can find me everywhere on YouTube, Twitter, and all those nice little places. And Telson and Adverse 2 is on Indiegogo. It's going to be closing soon because I'm going to be closing it soon because we're going to be fulfilling.
Yeah, boy. Yeah, yep. Boy.
And yep, right boy. Now I'm also working on the next three books. So, and, you know, Brian saw a few of them. It's going to be sweet.
Yeah.
2024, Year of the Dragon. And guess what I am?
Yeah. Well, can you be the dragon and the Wolverine at the same time?
Dude, I'm a dragon and a bull. So, yeah.
All right.
My birthday's May 1st. And don't forget that I do Doodle and Chill on the weekends.
Yeah, yeah. Dude, we got to set up a party. And PAX will be shown. Well, not my PAX, but... Do you know what I'm saying, Pops? Like, I'm going to be, like, shooting myself, like, from, like, the neck up, probably. How are you doing? How are you doing, man? Tell people where they can find you.
Right there, below me. No, not what Gracie has to say. I love you, Jeff, but get out of the way. I'm trying to point at you.
And, Mr. Bracey says that he would rather... have some Fulci. You know what? That will be next week's movie. It will be Four of the Apocalypse because that hits two birds, one stone. And that's because Four of the Apocalypse is directed by, of course, the notorious Italian horror director, Lucio Fulci. And this is a pretty gory, savage fucking movie. And it's basically like a horror Western. So we did a horror Western with, and God Said to Cain. So yeah, fuck it. Let's do another horror Western for next week.
Cool with me. Had a good time. I do have a new ad that I'm going to play. Cause
rock and roll.
Sim, you remember me talk? We were going to do the dispensary ad in the book.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm working on these guys. I'm working on these guys. So,
so this is a real dispensary?
Yeah, I have a spot. You know, just a little spot that we're doing because Harbor Farms, baby. You know.
Hell yeah, man! No, that sounds great.
Every time I go in there, I get a different cashier, right? Because I only go in there like once a month. So every time I go in there, I'm talking to somebody different. I'm dropping my card on them. I'm telling them about how there's always product placement.
Right.
On our shows whenever I'm out here. I'm always talking about them. I got two different coffee cups that have their sticker on it. And, it's like
that's hustling, man.
That's where I go, right, to get my stuff.
Yeah.
So everybody down there knows me now. It's like I walk in, it's like, Pops, and so it's like, I might as well.
The only thing that would be better than walking into like a LCS and seeing one of my comics on the shelf, the only thing that would be better than that would be to walk into a head shop and see one of my comics sitting on a shelf or in a spinner rack or something.
I'm trying to build a business relationship with these guys so that I can maybe get some people's comics.
Oh my God, that shit would be funny.
Why not, God. Right?
Oh, fuck yeah. Hey, dude, it's cross-marketing. You know what I'm saying? We got to try different things. And
I know a bunch of people that are writing books that have to do with partiers and, weed and whatever. And it's like,
oh, God, Florida, man, would be fucking perfect for fucking head shops.
There's tons of them, dude.
Yes. Although I don't think you could go into a head shop and look at Toad.
And look at what?
If you've read Hogs of Florida Man versus Hogzilla, there is some excessive toad licking going on.
Yeah, in that book. They don't care.
Hail Mike Baron.
But yeah, all right. I got a new ad for that, and then of course we got the Gods of Metal ad. I want to play a couple of these ads
before. Okay, all right, Sim. let me. I got the thing with the boxes. But yeah, hit me up about those Rillas, about the the package.
I need to pack everything up and send it to you and figure out which shipping I'm gonna use, because it's either Purolator or, you know, somebody told me to try.
All I know is it's gonna be brutal. Those Gorilla minis are on their way.
Yeah, they're all done.
Mr. Bracey down there. Mr. Bracey's a pretty accomplished artist himself, guys.
Well, dude, if you ever have any links to drop, or if you want to come on promote something,
he's part of the game stream and stuff, the RPG stream, the Slaughterville stream. He's the doctor.
Oh, okay.
He's the doctor in the Slaughterville RPG game. So
Dr. Giggles.
We gotta have fun, man. We gotta have fun out here.
Fun is essential, man.
By the way, for the Gorillas thing, I was even thinking of getting somebody and driving to the fucking US.
Oh, that might.
I have my passport, but I don't know if my friend has one.
Man, well, you know you're not that far. I do have an extra room.
Yeah,
if you want to crash, Buffalo isn't that far.
No, I'm like an hour. I'm like an hour away. An hour and a half away from the border, I think. So it's gonna be the. I think I'm that far. I was gonna ask Coleman, but I don't think he had. I don't know if he has his passport. And you know, getting a passport right now, it's a bit complicated.
Oh God, I can imagine. And real quick, gotta show these off.
That's beautiful.
Look at sweet. That.
That's cool.
Isn't it? Yeah, I mean, I'm just super lucky to be working with the people that I'm working with, obviously. And so that's Preston's, and this is Dillard's. You can see the fallen cowboy.
Mm-hmm. Ah!
And like the arm looked a little wonky, so I busted his balls, got on his ass, and he fixed it. So, yeah, Six Gun Gorilla stuff on the way. You're gonna hopefully. Get a couple of pages lettered and launch the campaign either at the end of this month or the beginning of next month.
And, you know, one thing I'd like to say before we leave, dude, if you haven't backed Tales from Nadverse 2 yet, what the fuck are you waiting for? It's 116.
What are you doing with your life?
It's 116 fucking page, not 48. Not six. Dude, the size of it, it's way worth your $25.
I think it's actually scientifically proven that if you haven't backed Tales from Nadverse yet, you're an idiot.
All right. What I'm showing right now is some of the art that we're going to be auctioning off at the Madness 4.
Oh, that's right. That's what those 20th. Auction.
This is Bill Moss, guys.
I love that.
We also have some pages from Bill Moss from Return to Hell Space, Zen and Nira X, the Zen book, Return to Hell Space.
That's right. He's
that's an old comic from the 90s, if I remember right. Right?
That was like it was a indie comic that he self-published, I think.
Because I remember seeing it here. Yeah.
First Comics did this book, but there's also a this was an unpublished cover from that book as well.
I never remember Zen being a First Comic. I could be wrong though.
Did this book return?
They're my favorite publishers.
I don't even know what First Comics is, but I remember seeing Zen here though in my comic book.
Oh my God, Sim, you've never have you ever read Grimjack?
Grimjack? That doesn't ring a bell.
There's a Zen crowdfunder right now.
You need it.
There's a Zen crowdfunder right now on Kickstarter.
I know.
That's awesome. But yeah, if we meet up at a convention or something like that, Sim, me and Preston need to like hold you down and just beat on your legs until they're like linguine.
What?
And force you to read Grimjack, because you are missing out.
Grimjack?
You have Grimjack. Especially like those first 10 issues or so. Oh,
no, never saw that, dude. I never saw that here.
Oh, dude, look, you check it out. You will be in for a treat. I promise you.
Tim Truman and Josh Ostrander.
John Ostrander.
Yeah,
we
got Bill Moss. We got Jim O'Reilly. I got a bunch of art. The 420 Madness Art Auction / Sale. We're going to put a buy it now price on everything, right?
Yeah.
And if nobody goes for it, then we go for the auction. But look, I'm not going to undersell Bill's stuff.
No, fuck that.
Okay. This is Bill freaking Moss. I'm not going to undersell his stuff. Right?
Yeah, no, fuck that. But,
hey, we're going to have some cool stuff. Please come out, because every bit of the money that we get is going to go toward the Roku, the foundation for the Roku platform.
And yeah, that's baby. What we're
doing. So,
yeah, baby. Yeah, baby. I'm not going to have to use like euphemisms like grape.
Anything that we make, whether it's like from a super chat or anything, any money that comes in right now is all going towards the Madness.
Thank network, you, Bracey.
The Roku network. Every bit of it. So,
you know. Hell yeah. Hell yeah.
And trust me, everybody knows not. People really like Rose, and people also really like El Rico.
Waiting for number
two. And I've seen it. I've read the shit, and it's fire. And Sim has stepped up his game, and he has leveled up. And that is one of the truly great joys of being part of this scene and, you know, being friends with people like Sim, like Preston, like Matt, like a bunch of other of our peeps, is watching people getting better. And mm-hmm. yeah, and that's gonna be a big fat book too, like cartoonishly.
Yeah, the only thing that's pissing me off is, you know, how can I say, the first campaign to me doesn't count because, you know, I had to cancel it because of the things for the delay, but it's still annoying, that delay. So trust me, it's gonna be worth the wait.
Yeah, he's gonna make it up to you. Yes. Well, yes. That's the thing that we do. If we're late or something like that, shit happens. That's beyond our control.
But that's what happened, because when I relaunched, it was now 116 pages instead of 100.
But see, like, here's the weird thing that like happened with me. I couldn't back it on Indiegogo, remember? Wouldn't take
Money. They wouldn't let him. So I told him, you know, you go, can I do it through PayPal? Yeah, send it to me.
I had to send him the money through PayPal. It was like,
and I told him, though, if you don't, if I forget you, remind me.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Remind me when I say it's time to fulfill. Because I don't, it's not in my.
That's what I hate about Kickstarter. On Kickstarter, you don't get people's addresses. What you get is you have to send out a survey, and then the people who back the campaign respond to you, but not everybody responds to you.
Yep.
So there's always a bunch of people that never responded to the surveys. It's like, I want to get you the damn book that you ordered.
And after a year, they lock it down. So I had to send them a message, write a paper asking them to give me access to it again.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
Yes, we're not looking to build.
I want to be able to fulfill. And they're like, oh, we're really happy to see your energy to want to fulfill it.
Yes, motherfuckers.
That's why I hate Kickstarter, to be quite honest. Yeah, and that's why I've always been mainly on fucking Indiegogo.
Yeah.
Because it takes care of all that shit for me. The only thing I don't like is that fucking tipping shit.
The tipping is super fucking shifty. And then,
but they all have it. Everybody has it.
GoFundMe. GoFundMe has that shit too. I found out people go to donate to me to the GoFundMe for the Roku, and they're like, "Dude, did you know GoFundMe has a tip thing?" I'm like, "Just put zero on that shit, man."
Yeah.
They're
all counting on people not paying attention.
They're asking you to tip a fucking person at the cashiers because she spins the fucking controller.
They're already getting their cut. You don't have to give them no more. Fuck them.
It's ridiculous. It's so scummy. But that's why when we launch these relaunch of the Six Gun Gorilla Volume 2 campaign, it's going to be on funmycomic.com.
There you go. Fight.
All right, Pops, you want to take us out?
Yeah. Do your thing.
Okay. All right. Sim, great seeing you, brother. Pops, great seeing you, man. I'm gonna go get some nom noms. Everybody else, until we see you next week, you get the peace and the love and the metal. Metal! Up your ass!
Mr. Chris, what up? Also, Chris Kale from rock and roll band Five Finger Death Punch. Heard that you're about to launch your newest board game, Gods of Metal, where you take on the persona of different metal musicians to stop the overlords and their demons from taking over reality. I think I know a metal musician that can help you fight those overlords and those demons. That is me, Chris Kale. So, shout out to you, Chris. Shout out to all of the Laughing Rogue crew. And shout out to Gods of Metal. I will be in there taking over reality from the demons and the overlords. Chris Kale. Just like it says there on my hat, in case I forget. I do play bass.
An ancient darkness is breaking through into our reality. The overlords are coming. Their demons united, they'll stop at nothing to tear our world to shreds. And the only thing that can stop them is the power of metal. You have been chosen by the gods of metal to lead this crusade of finger-shredding fury. You must write the sick riffs, craft the awesome lyrics, find unholy rhythms, and set the heads banging. Show the overlords that their darkness is nothing compared to yours. Gods of Metal is a co-op deck-building game for 1 to 4 players. You and your bandmates must work to create the most powerful band in human history. Find mystical instruments of legend, outlandish costumes to improve your powers, and recruit mascots to help you battle the overlords. Find the power of pure decibels and use them to destroy your enemies by crafting songs that will literally blow their minds. Form a band. Save the world. Gods of Metal. Now on Kickstarter.
Yo, you know me, Tom Van Zandt from the Madness Comic Network. I need to take the edge off. I trip my little ass right on down to Harbor Farms on 131 in Three Rivers, Michigan. Get all your flowers, gummalummies, pre-rolls, even sugar shots. Man, look, this is the place I go if you're in Southwest Michigan. Check out Harbor Farms, man. They got all kinds of cool stuff. You'll love it. Peace.
The future. The final frontier. It has never been so uncertain as now. AI, VR, hapticware, nanotechnology, mass destruction with a remote click. Now we are finally seeing the true potential and dangers of an ever-connected and overly policed hyper-technological world. Have we finally become the architect of our own demise? Is there still hope? Welcome to the future. Welcome to Punk Droid.
Thank you. City Magazine is just really pulling out all the stops, man. Your guys' production value of this magazine has gone insane. I mean, look at that. I mean, I remember when you guys, it was black and white. Even when it was black and white, I thought your quality was great. But damn, they have just, I mean, they're just really stepping it up a notch. Look at this. James Corbett, boys. James Corbett.
Genuinely cutting, but also funny, and obviously just chaotic and very fun.
I love Flip City. It has brought new types of badassery and integrity to the print medium.